Are you quiet?
No, I'm just turning off my phone.
Turn your phone on silent or turn it down so we don't have to go off. Leon?
Sir?
Is your phone on?
If you have a marine team, you know that it's still on.
Okay. This is our 15th or 16th year to go do this. This is sponsored by the Gladewater Beer and the Gladewater Garden Club. And I appreciate the ladies very much for all the cookies and stuff. I appreciate the church for allowing us to come into the church and this. It's very nice of them, and I appreciate Dick very, very much.
This is a
Jim, how's climate control?
I'm sorry?
How's climate control?
I'm just fine.
Good.
Good.
Like I said, this is the 15th year that we... 15th, 16th year we did. The first year we did the actual incumbent, only one incumbent showed up. But they thought it was a trick. And two of them did not get re-elected. So I guess it wasn't a trick. But anyway, it's a straightforward thing. You know, we just want everybody to go talk, ask them questions off the cards. We don't take any questions from the floor. The reason is, we found in past things is that it gets out of hand, you get personalities involved, and our job is to not do that. We just want the facts. Okay. Anyway, this is the process. Each candidate will have 1 minute to go answer the question. If they don't use up their whole minute, they simply do not get that time later. Okay? At the end of it, each candidate will be given 2 minutes to go sum up and to tell you why in the world you should vote for them. Suzanne is our moderator, and she will ask the questions. We have gone through the questions that you had. We probably have time for only 9 or 10, so obviously not all of them will get asked. If we didn't ask yours, it is not because I know who it is or I don't like you. You might not like me, I don't know. But anyway, it's just we picked the best question, and there were several questions that were the same. Okay, there are 5 or 6 that are all the same in the same general idea. So, anyway, with that said, yes, ma'am?
If we can't hear, can we raise our hand? Because I don't think everybody's going to be able to, unless you move the speaker around.
We're going to try to do it without the microphone.
Okay.
Now, can y'all hear me in the back?
Yes.
Can
you? Not very good.
Okay.
I can be loud enough.
Oh, I know you can.
We've always been okay
to mine. Well, I know we can.
Right now.
And
it's,
people can hear me.
It's stretched under the.
Around. I was just trying to. I'm trying
it's under the table.
Avoid it again.
It'll have to go back up under the table.
Okay.
Do it like this.
No, it's long enough.
Yeah.
It'll work, Dick. It's long enough.
Okay.
Check 1, 2, 3.
Okay.
There you go.
I'll take one. Would you start us out with a prayer?
Yeah.
And you can all rise, please.
God, you've made it clear that we as your people need to be the social consciousness of our town and our community in which we live. And so I thank you for these people who deem it important enough to make good, sound decisions, to come out tonight and to make their choice. Because God, we know that if our decisions aren't sound, our quality of life is going to be lacking. So I thank you for that. Thank you for these men and women up here that have taken their time to come and answer the questions, that have given of their time in service to this city. And I thank you for the desire for those who want to be of service to the rest of us. So again tonight, we're looking forward under you, under this roof of worship, that that we just offer what's going on here to you, and that you will lead our thoughts and our minds as we endeavor to make the decisions and say the things that are pleasing to you. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. We have Leon Watson and Larry Seery running for one seat. We have Harold Wells and Mark Carpenter running for another seat. We have Mark Hay, Lana Niemann, and Jonathan Allen, who is not here, running for place three. Is that correct? Three. Two, mayor, and three. So we're going to start with Leon. Tell us your name, how many years you have lived here, and if you currently serve or don't serve.
My name is Leon Watson. I have been living in Gladewater for over 73 years, and I'm currently serving on the city council. I've been on it 6 years now. First time I've had an opponent.
Thanks, Larry.
Y'all got a choice, and the choice is up to you. But
what else can I say?
That's it, right?
Good evening. I'm Larry Seery. I moved here in all the way from Longview, I think 85, somewhere in there. Yeah. Lived here ever since. Guess that's it.
Harold Wells, age 75, been on the mayorship for going on 4 years, served on the city council for approximately 7 years. I was back on the city council for 1979 and 1980. And chose to work more with the Chamber of Commerce back in 1980. Thank you.
Hi, Mark Carpenter. Moved here in January 2005 to take over a old abandoned oil field that everybody told me I was crazy to do and would never amount to anything. And I've sold 200,000 barrels of oil out of that worthless lease. I know how to get things done. I'm running for mayor this time. This is my 11th time, so I'm hoping 11's a lucky number.
My name is Lana Niemann. I've been here since 2006. I moved to Longview in 1981 and stayed in that area for, I guess, 12 years, was gone for seven, then came back here. I currently am serving as councilperson in place three and look forward to this forum tonight.
Hello, I'm Mark May, and moved here in December of 06. Currently not on the council, but looking forward to hopefully an opportunity to serve.
Okay, I'm Suzanne Bardwell, and it is my privilege tonight to serve as your moderator. And there are a lot of questions here that are excellent, and I hope we have time to cover as many of them as possible. I'd like to remind you that you have 1 minute to make your response, so please be aware of that. And Jim will signal you over here. Let's start with a general one first. And let's start with Mr. Leon down here. What is your vision and plan for business recruitment and residential recruitment?
Okay, start with the residential recruitment. If you have a good citizenship here and schools and a good administration, people will come to Gladewater. Now, as far as recruiting business to come here, we have to make the town look attractive. And I attended a conference a few years ago at the TML, where the speaker said, if you don't want to hire, a responsibility is to get new business come in is the city council. Okay, if you don't want to get out and do that yourselves, you could hire this company to come in, evaluate your city, and make recommendations. And so that's what I would like to do, working through the business we have and the resources we have. We have, am I through?
You wrap up.
Okay. GEDCO, our Economic Development Corporation, I think is doing an excellent job. And working the city council, working with them, I think we can bring more business here.
Okay. Mr. Larry.
Same question.
Yes, sir. Vision and plan for business recruitment and residential recruitment.
Well, you know, I believe in Gladewater. I've invested heavily in it. And we've made our RV park one of the top in the nation. It's, the 12,000 parks were the top 300. So we have done something right, and I think I can do that on council. Like Leon said, you got to clean your town up. It needs to be attractive. It needs to be pleasing. We're getting a new school, wonderful, wonderful new school. That's going to be great. We've got the ball field. That was a good deal. It is good for our youth and our young men. I know a lot of people don't think it is, but you need stuff like that. If your young men move away, who's going to build? Who's going to build? All these things go together. Business, we have a great guy at GEDCO. Robert is sharp. He's on the ball. He wrote the book. He knows what he's doing. And he is working to get us stuff. But each one of us can. You never know who, when you're talking to somebody, you might put a spark in their mind that might get somebody here. So, okay.
Thank you. I feel like that, you know, of course, when we're out working, that we should look around and see where the problem spots is, and I enjoy that adopted spot that we've got going. If it's trashy, that seems like that's the first thing people notice. Of course, we're getting a lot of good attention on our baseball field and our new school, but then if you hire the right people like Robert and Kathy, they're going to bring the business in if we're just ready for them. And we're going to have to be ready for them. And the antique dealers are down there. I feel like we need to work more with them, because our whole town downtown is just antique dealers and two or three cafes here and there.
Well, I'll just reiterate, you need to clean up the town. You don't necessarily have to pay people to do it. I mean, every citizen can clean up. I mean, when my wife and I walk around the lake walking that dog, we take plastic bag, her to clean up after the dog, me to clean up after the people. Because on a weekend, there's plenty to pick up. On Mondays when we go, we fill up a bag three or four times, and it's kind of a win-win. On getting businesses here, that's tough. GEDCO is doing a good job. I would like GEDCO to be a 4B Corp instead of a 4A Corp, but I've been singing that song for a long time and not been very successful at it. But I'd like to work with GEDCO and get the town cleaned up as much as possible to encourage people and show them that we're proud to be here.
My vision is that we don't have any empty stores or lots in town, but that we get a good balance and diversified in types of businesses that we have, both retail and industrial. The way of doing that is that we continue to work on our incentives through the Chapter 380 agreements, which allows incentives other than tax abatements, such as water meters, lines, things like that, that will help out businesses without tax abatements. Working with major corporate investors and brokerage firms such as the Steinbeck Corporation, they are out of the Dallas area. They facilitate for a lot of different people, Subways, CVS's, a lot of different corporations. They're the ones who got the McDonald's here. They would love to work with us continually. They love small communities. To put another strip mall in Gladewater, and you know, we have to maintain those types of relationships with investors. And in order to get this vision to happen, we have to keep our incentives and, of course, our beautification and things like that we'll talk about later. But those would be the incentives and the way that I would get business recruitment in through those corporations.
Okay, you had some good answers. We do have good schools, and we have good opportunities. we do need to clean the town up. And I'm not saying that it's bad, I'm just saying there's areas that need some help. And a clean town is an attractive town. The chamber is more active now than ever, and I think they're working diligently to help get things done and get things moving in the city that we desperately need. And Gedco's working, that's where the business comes in. And residential, you know, if we just take a minute and clean up our own area, it'd do a lot. You know, when a lot of people are doing a little bit, it goes a long ways. It doesn't mean just a few. So if you see your street's not quite right, clean it up. After all, this is where we live and we work and we play. And it's up to us to make it what we want it to be. And that's what I see.
Hold on to that microphone. And while we have the opportunity for an advertisement, we'd like you all to sign up for Adopt a Spot. And you can see Todd Clifton, and he will be happy to take down your information. Sorry, I'm just striking while the iron is hot. Thank you for assisting, all of you. Okay, so here's a pretty serious problem that we're facing. As a council person, how will you deal with the continued water problems and the quality of water?
Well, the infrastructure and the water problem, I think, has been a problem for a long, long time. It's been dealt with and then not dealt with. And in order to change that, the water lines are old, the water lines has got to be fixed. And eventually, we've got to bite the bullet and just do it. You hear people complaining all the time. I hear people tell me that when they draw their bath water, it looks like clay. It's red, and they can't take a bath. I hear a good number of people tell me they can't drink the water. A number of people tell me they buy their water. These are things that are unattractive to getting new people to the town. But if we don't step up now and take care of this problem, when are we going to do it? You know, a couple of mains break, we're in trouble. And is that it?
I agree with Mark, that is definitely an issue, but I would like to say that we are working on that, and we have been working on that. It has been neglected since 1930. The lines that were put in are pipelines and clay pipe. Those are going to disintegrate and they're going to rust. You cannot replace everything at the same time. It's just not feasible to do that economically or in replacing all lines at all times. We have replaced about 3% of it this past year, a little over 17,000 linear feet, which is about 3% of that. At this going rate, it would take about 30 years to replace all lines. These lines will last about 30 years, and then we're going to have the same thing again. You have to do it in a structural way. We are faced with things that have not been replaced over the last 40, 50, 60, even 80 years. So in order to do that, we have to fund it properly. We have to do it in a manner of which lines are first, which lines are the most detrimental at the time. They're not always the most favorite lines that like to, somebody on one street wants one thing and another. We have facilitated a new water plant that is an excellent water plant, but what comes out of there, even if it's clean coming out of that plant, then you have to understand that the lines it's going through is still not going to get to your house clean. So we are working on the line problem along with the other issues with the water.
Man, replacing 3% of the water lines, that tells you how much further we have to go. And it costs money. It's kind of like the streets. It costs a lot of money to repave streets. And we have a tight budget. We've got a $6.2 million a year budget. And it's very difficult to spend the amount of money it requires on the water pipes that do need to be replaced. You know, when we borrowed, I think, $3.8 million on a CDO that was supposed to go strictly for the water plant or the water system, and we spent $1.7 million of it on high-tech water meters. I would have preferred to replace pipe and use the meters we have. I'm big on using what we have.
Thank you. The water's always been a problem. We came here in 1974. Of course, the city council always seems to inherit someone else's problem, and it's passed on from council to council. But sometimes the water tastes like too much Purex, too much bleach, whatever. But then I think folks are getting tired of excuses, because we do have a new water plant, spent a lot of money for it. But then one thing we forgot to flush the lines. Those lines are old, but then we've got a new city manager here. I think he understands what our needs are, but these lines have to be flushed out. So we're flushing more and more lines, and I think that's gonna help. But we don't have the money to just go in there and start digging up those lines. I noticed that we had 3 broken on Westlake, like in 1 week. So all we've done is replacing that section of it, putting down new pipe there, clamping it off, and keep on moving. So on the water, we're doing the best we can without what I call totally going broke. Thank you.
You know, the water comes out of the lake. When there's big rains, there's a lot of runoff. I wish I could tell you the name of the thing that brings. It was Gonzales or something like it. Casey told me the name, that it causes the water to be bad for a while. There are 3 different levels that can take water out of that lake. And the mechanism that does that is shot. The screens in front of it are shot. I think they call it a collector or something. Take about $100,000 to fix that, and we're gonna try to get that in next year's budget. There's a lot of things that can be done to be improved. I know about water lines. I was with the school. I was a plumber with the school for 5 years. And I remember Gay Avenue, we had a steam line in the ceiling. I had so many stainless steel clamps on it, there wasn't room for any more clamps. It's the same way with the city. It's old. The problem started 30, 40 years ago. It wasn't addressed, and we've inherited them. And, you know, just I think the city's doing the best it can.
Came to Gladewater in 1942, so I've seen the water come and go here in these conditions. And you have to consider now, before the oil boom, Gladewater had a population of approximately 600. We exported lumber and cotton. When the oil boom hit in 1931, our population grew to over 10,000. This caused the city fathers to get out there and lay water lines, gas lines, whatever, wherever they could. Consequently, we have lines that no one knows where they stop and no or where they start. And we've experienced that in working the gusher days, trying to find where the water lines start. Now the city has spent a lot of money on the new water plant. It's done a lot better. The water lines were ran on the back part of Gay Avenue through some personal property. Now that property, when we got ready to lay our new water lines, we couldn't get a hold of some of the owners. So what we had to do was go up right along the highway, Gay Avenue, and lay the new water lines. This way, if anything happens to those water lines, we can do it on our property. Now, one more thing. The water out here, I know last week I couldn't drink the water out of that we were getting. This week I could drink it. It's because the wind had turned up water up out there at the lake and caused it to taste bad.
This is going to be a 2-part question, and it's going to change when we go from incumbent to a new person running. So I'll repeat it every time so y'all can focus on it. Okay. The new $2.3 million ball field complex will open soon. So for the incumbents, why did you not ask the voters to weigh in on this project since it obligates them to pay for it?
I guess the reason we didn't, because we were desperate for a ball field to build so our kids would have a place to play. Back when my 3 sons were growing up, we played on a ballpark down on the East Pacific, just on the other side of the fire tower. Spencer family came to us and said, buy it or move. So we moved down on the loop where Roy Pearman went down with the city equipment and built those. Then the school decided they needed to build a new campus. Lo and behold, we've got to move again. And we're pressed for time in getting a new ballpark. My suggestion was, being on the council, let's build it on city property so we don't have to get booted out again. Now, we did our best to try to get this going before the baseball season started this year.
Mr. Seery?
Yes.
Would you have asked the voters to vote on the ball field had you been on the council?
The way it was presented to the council, it was going to be self-supporting. It was going to make its own payments. And if something makes its own payments, that's not bad. And they felt that it was really desirable to have this. And so I think I'd have done the same thing.
Mr. Wells?
Okay. Kind of a tough question. Sometimes you have to do it on the advice of your city manager. And at that time, we were led to believe that that would be not be no problem for us getting it here, relocating it right there where it is, and it would be our ballpark, quote, as a city, that we could make it, we could have tournaments here, it would be, it would pay for itself. So sometimes you look back and you think, okay, if we'd have done it by a vote or not done it by a vote, we went ahead and did it without a vote. I personally am for it all the way, and I would not like to have seen it got voted down. So whatever it happens, we're into it mud up our knees right now. But we're going to stay with it, and we're going to make it work with y'all's help. Thank you.
Mr. Carpenter, would you have done things differently?
I would have tried to put it out to the citizens and let them vote on it. $2.3 million is too much money for seven people to obligate 6,500 people to do. You know, I'm not against the ballpark. It's already been built, but I just wish we'd stop borrowing money to build things. And I wish we could put some money aside and have a capital fund to pay for stuff and pay as we go. And I've been told that we can't do that because we're too small of a town, don't have enough money. But now we're paying over $1 million in debt payments per year. So I don't know why we couldn't have set aside half of that 5 years ago and been able to pay as we go. But there are no easy solutions. And I know it's very politically attractive to say you're for the ball field. I'm not against the ball field, but I think we should have gotten more bids and tried to live within our means. I've heard that Kilgore had a similar situation. The first bid they got was too high. So they said, no, we're not going to spend that money, and they waited. And then they got some more bids and they got a better deal. I don't know if that's true or not. I haven't researched that, but that's what I've heard.
The ballpark is something that I think we all learn when we're on council. You don't come into being on council and just have all the answers or know the right things to do. You learn as you go. As far as the ballpark goes, I think that it was a good investment for Gladewater. I think that our, not just for, but it again, it's warm and fuzzy to say it's for our youth, and it is for our youth, but it's more than that. Quality of life issues face Gladewater, and we have to have different types of diversified things that will get younger families here, get more people here, and we have to be able to facilitate diversity in keeping our rating and keeping investors who want to come to our town. We have to have different things to offer. The ballpark, the projection is in 5 years it will start paying for itself. So yes, we did take on a burden. I think it was a burden that will pay off in the future.
In my opinion, we should have took it to the people. And that being said, the council was quick to judgment. I mean, they stated, I've heard that said here tonight. We were in a hurry, we were trapped, or we were pressured or something. And we're quick to judgment, and now we've got a $2.3 million burden that we need. I'm not saying we don't need ballparks. I'm saying we do need ballparks, but there should have been more time. That should have went out to bid as well. One bid should have had three bids. Should have went out to bid. But, and we can't blame just one person. There was a whole council that undertook this, and so we can't keep naming one person and lay that blame there. And it's not a blame as much as it is that everybody there had a chance to participate and vote the way they wanted to vote, and they did that. Now we got to rally together and put something together and make this happen. We've got to figure out how we're going to maintain it and keep it up. And these are things that might have not been thought of, but now we can think of that. And as a town, sometimes when something like this happens, it might make the town pull together and be a little stronger, and I hope that's what happens.
Okay. How important to you is it for the city of Gladewater to apply existing codes to dilapidated commercial and residential properties? While it's nice that our newspaper highlights potholes before and after, we have long tolerated the despicable deterioration of buildings along frequently traveled roads within the city limits. What can you do to put pressure on to get these codes enforced and to improve this situation? Please.
Well, the first thing, I believe there's some ordinances that's already in place that need to be enforced. And as far as the buildings are that are in bad shape is just as bad as residential homes that are in bad shape. All of this ties in together of we want to see a cleaner town. How do you see a cleaner town if we've got buildings that no roofs on them and windows boarded up? And then we've got homes that has a lot of problems. And so we've got it. We need to do what has been set forth and comply with it. I think sometimes we take off too big a bite and we miss the whole picture. We need to look at our surroundings. Sometimes you can get too close to the forest to see the trees, and it becomes a natural everyday scene. But there's some bad parts in the town, and if we don't fulfill the ordinances, then why do we have them?
The ordinances are just one piece of the puzzle. It's not like you can just say, we have an ordinance, let's go out and take care of every property that doesn't comply to that ordinance. That's just not the way that it works. We've started a multitude of programs. We've got the beautification committee now. We have home grant programs that, you know, there's afterwards you can look at these. We've gotten $1.2 million of replacing homes, dilapidated homes that look like this. Well, you can see, and then come out looking like a nice brick home afterwards. We have a lot of those programs in place to help with this. And most people aren't aware of all the things that are going on in Gladewater and about the cleanup, the beautification. And part of that is the ordinances. And to enforce those ordinances, it is a methodical type situation of where you have to start somewhere. You can't, like I said, you can't pick one ordinance and say, we've got to go apply this to everybody right now, and whoever doesn't have this in place has got to have it in place right now. It is by situations that come up, whether it is a home inspection that happens, whether it is an incident that happens. Someone reports something to our inspector, our code enforcement. Those come from you. Those come from you. You have to make a complaint, or you have to bring it to the attention, and then our code enforcement looks at those and addresses that issue at that time.
That's another tough issue because there's so much of it out there. You know, the code enforcement officer, Al, is overwhelmed, in my opinion, with what he's been asked to do. And it's hard to enforce that fairly. I mean, people that get told you've got to fix this up or get a citation feel like they're being picked on, because a lot of other people never get spoken to, partly because you can't find them. I mean, there's a lot of abandoned property. And, you know, and I've heard some people say, well, we just need to bulldoze all that down. Well, that's not exactly the answer either, because as soon as you bulldoze that down, first of all, that costs money. Second of all, now you've got an empty lot that needs, that gets overgrown. So who's going to mow it? So I think it's a complicated issue. And I hope that we can all find some common ground and where people don't feel like they're being targeted. And we can just try to work together on that. But it's going to take a long time. Those houses, it's taking a long time to get in that bad of shape. It's going to take a long time to fix it. And it's going to take money.
Thank you. I feel like we need to go around, and when you're riding around, I know before Gusher Days came, me and some more people, we picked that a lot right down here across from Broadway. And we did that lot on our own, and the city just got through paying $8,000 to have that old two-story house tore down. So sometimes it wouldn't hurt on some of these vacant lots. Let's get out there with a weed eater and a lawnmower and stuff. We had that tree off, got it hauled off. On these old buildings downtown, I don't know what the answer on those things are, because some of the owners live out of town and seem like they're not concerned about what they do look like or what kind of hazard they might be. We got a lot of beautiful buildings downtown that the people that own them and they rent them from people, they take good care of them, and they're a pride to Gladewater. I see a lot of stuff because I guess I look for it all the time. And it's disgusting sometimes we spend so much money to get folks down to our town. And when they get here, you think, gosh, you know, is that what we're spending our money for? And one of them is our public restrooms. We don't even have a sign on it. I've asked Theo to put us a sign up there that says public restrooms. I know the merchants are getting tired of pointing, I call it, you know, they point this way, they point that way. But then, thank goodness they all have my cell phone number, and I don't mind going down there and stopping them. That's just part of when you have company coming. We live off the tourist, you know, really, when it comes right down to it. And so if you see something that, if you want to adopt it or not adopt it, just do it on there. Thank you.
When I decided to run for council, I wanted to know more than I did. So I've been to the sewer plant, I've been to the water plant. I have seen all the sewer diagrams for the city, all the water diagrams. I can't tell you how much have been replaced, but I remember looking at all the lines and seeing they are working on all this stuff. Al took me around and showed me all the houses. And there's some are decrepit, but they're 60, 80, 100 years old. I mean, they're old houses. And this is something that isn't going to happen right away. I'm asked Todd to be put on the beautification committee, and I want to get out and work with people and help do that. And I think that's what it's going to take. It's going to take a bunch of us getting involved and telling other people, you know, you got a nice house there. If you did so-and-so out here, it'd really look sharp. If we get people excited about it themselves, they may do something with it. The old buildings downtown, maybe we can get some of them leased and get them fixed up. That's there isn't a whole lot you can do there. I mean, a lot of them had the same walls. You get into a lot of structural problems. So that's a can of worms.
And again, I've been in Gladewater since 1942. My dad would never buy a house here. He'd always say, I'm going back to the Ozarks someday. So he used that excuse. But I don't like that since wife and I got married. We had built a house here in 71. And we had a good builder. And we look around, and there's some of the houses here are dilapidated. What is that doing to the property value of the people that have a good house? So what we need to do is pass this ordinance so that our inspector can do the job that he was hired to do. Now, it's not going to be easy, and he's going to get some help. And let me tell you, folks, We have hit a gold mine when we got Theo.
Malafon.
Renardson. The Raging Cajun. I don't think he would get by me saying that. But this guy is amazing, let me tell you. He's got some great ideas for the city of Gladewater. He came a week early, and he's hit the ground running. And he hasn't let up since. But he's done a fantastic job, and he's got plans. And he shared some of them with me. I cannot talk about them now, not till we have our council meeting and bring it up to the council.
This is a question that kind of goes along with that, I suppose. Despite claims of continued growth, why do we have so many, why do you think, obviously your individual opinion, why do you think we have so many unoccupied and distressed buildings, despite the fact that we're talking about, you know, we're going to bring these people in, we're going to bring these people in, but we have these...
You speak of commercial buildings?
I suppose so. That's not my question, so.
Okay. It's hard for me to speak of a commercial building. Of course, growing up here, we had a JCPenney's, a Kay Woolen, we had about five jewelry stores and saddle shop and all that. When the oil started dropping out, it seemed like these businesses went away. While I was at school here, I'd ask some of my classmates, where do you live? They have an Humble Camp, City Service Camp, Texas Camp. They live in a lot of oil camps. That losing the oil has really hurt the economy here. And let me tell you something else that I have observed, and many of you, I'm sure, have noticed the same thing. Growing up here, Highway 80 was the main east-west highway. It went all the way from coast to coast. When Interstate 20 came in, that hurt us. Believe it or not, if you drive 15 miles out here to get to Interstate before you go the same distance going to Dallas. And when I'm going to Dallas, folks, I take Highway 80. I don't go out there and fool with that Interstate. But getting back to the buildings, I don't know really have an answer on what it would take to get them brought up to code. Unless this ordinance addresses these buildings and gets them up to code.
A lot of the buildings downtown are flat roofs. If you've had any experience with flat roofs, they leak. I know the old furniture store. He had buckets sitting every 2 or 3 foot in there every time it rained. That's a big problem. It cost a small fortune to get them fixed, and then they may not be fixed. You may have to do it a couple of times. And I think a lot of people have just got tired of putting money in the old buildings. They're not worth that much. Like Leon said, it's a can of worms. I'm not sure what we can do about it. Hopefully we could get some new money in here. People really wanting to put in a business or two, and they would invest in it. I know of several situations. I know a man that owns several buildings, and he put new roofs on every one of them, and they're existing and doing well. But it takes somebody like that with a little bit of insight that can look ahead and see opportunity and do something with it. And that's what it's going to take.
Thank you. I was just looking on this brochure that we put down at the public toilets on there, like the museum, Greenwood's, R&S Clocks, the screen door, St. Clair Antique Emporium, Omar's, Walker Manor, Gladewater Mirror, Gladewater Antique Mall, Decorate Ornates, Country Girl Collections, Christie Collections, Antiques and Oddities, and Antiques too. These folks are professional business people. They own those buildings. They take care of those buildings. Some of those you set vacant, they were doomed from the time they opened the door. Some of those buildings had owners, not owners, I'd say, renters in it back and forth. They really didn't know how to run a business, I don't think. But I'm proud of the ones that's on the back of this brochure, and I didn't probably get every one of them down there. But a lot of them you would like to go in there and say, look, you're not doing it right. You know, you come down here and you're not doing it right, and you're doomed to fail on this part. And some of them don't give it time. They come in with very little money and not much banking, I call it, business. And so then the next thing you know, they're out of business from there. So that's another vacant building. Thank you.
I understood the question to be not just strictly about the buildings, but about residences as well. Is that correct, or? Ask the question again.
We have one coming up that's, I think, similar to what you're saying. Despite claims of continued growth, why do we have so many unoccupied and distressed buildings? So I think that means downtown.
Okay. Well, the claims of continued growth, I mean, the population of Gladewater is roughly 6,500. I think that was, when I moved here 10 years ago, it was 6,300. So percentage-wise, we haven't grown that much. And, you know, for the buildings for renovation and preservation, that is a tough thing to do without resources. You know, there's, I know the Main Street Board probably knows more about preservation, I would assume. But it takes money. I mean, you know, we keep getting back to the same problem. Well, how do we clean up the town? How do we make it more attractive? And all those problems that we have take resources or money. And we've already got our tax rate up to the highest of any city in East Texas that my research has proven. And I can't find any town that has as high of a tax rate as we do. And that discourages people from coming into town when they have a high tax rate. You know, this is kind of funny. I find it funny. When that Powerball lotto was up to $1.5 billion, I kept thinking, I wish somebody in Gladewater would win it and just pay off all the city debt and we just start over, you know. But that's not a plan. That's just a dream.
I'm one of those people who touts that we have continued growth, and I do think that we've had growth. Growth is not just in one area. We have growth in when we fix more roads, when we fix more water lines, when we get new fire trucks, when we get all of these things that are happening inside this city, that is continued growth. If not, we're going to be the same place that we were with our water lines and things that have been neglected over the years. So yes, we've had growth in those areas. We've had growth in our industrial businesses that are in town. We've had growth in our retail businesses in town. Our downtown does not reflect that growth. And these are problems that we face as a city, and we are looking really hard at how we can establish something downtown to help. The only way that we can help the businesses downtown, we can't do everything for the people. They don't expect it. They, you know, Margaret does not expect us to come into her building and take care of her building for her. But the only way we can help Margaret is by, or any of the other downtown folks, is by increasing what we do here and how many people we can get into this town. And that raises our sales tax, puts more money in our pockets to do things. It puts more money in the people who own the businesses' pockets in order to maintain and facilitate their buildings. So for the downtown purposes, we have revitalization you know, in progress. We have education, we have several different media outlets and signage and projects and events that are going to be going on in downtown to help downtown revitalize itself. We're only a piece of the puzzle. The city can do so much, the citizens can do so much. And it's together is what it's going to take to make it happen.
Well, I don't have all the answers. I just simply will say I'm not sure why the buildings are like they are. We probably should ask the people though. If they need help, if the buildings are not in good shape, it's the responsibility of the person that owns that building. I don't have the answer. I know that, again, they didn't get this way overnight, so it's been happening for a while. But empty buildings is not an answer to growth. We need to fill those buildings, and I think everybody sitting here would agree to that. But the building owners have to be contacted, and I heard someone a while ago say that some of them live out of town and can't be contacted. I'm not sure about that. They bought that building somehow. There's a copy of a deed somewhere. There's a name and a phone number somewhere, or an address, And maybe Al needs to check in that way and find out who owns those buildings and find out what their intentions are. That's about all I can say about that.
Okay. Would you support letting the voters change GEDCO from a 4A to 4B with control under city manager and council like any other city department? And if so, do you think by doing this and GEDCO focusing on quality of life projects that it would help relieve the budget and be able to lower the tax rate? Do I need to read it?
I'm in favor of GEDCO being a 4A or a 4B. I'm in favor of whatever makes the most sense for Gladewater. And I think that's always been for all the GEDCO board and the people that are in the GEDCO area, that we've all been open to, in city, been open to whatever is best for the city. And if that's what's best for the city, then definitely I would be for it.
Oh, I'm definitely for it being 4B. I've been singing that song for 8-9 years or so. The main disadvantage, I've been told by Robert Johnson and some of the board members over the years, is that the 4A is mainly for industrial, and you can keep confidential for 60 days. No, you can keep it confidential when you're negotiating with another business. If you're trying to get a business from Kilgore or Longview, you can keep that confidential. If you're a 4B Corp, you cannot. You have to publish before you make a deal with a new business. You have to publish it, and it's public knowledge. So for 60 days, that's out there. And what they're concerned about is that you know, the town that's losing this business will go and say, wait, don't leave. We'll give you a better deal. We'll up the ante a little bit over what Gladewater or GEDCO was going to give you. And I believe what they told me is true. I just think the advantage of being a 4B outweigh the advantage of being a 4A. I've done research on this, and there's been a lot of economic development corporations that they were originally 4A that converted to 4B. And since they started this, the 1990s when they started, and then the overwhelming new economic development corporations are 4B, not 4A. And there's been, I don't know the exact number, but lots that were changed from 4A to 4B, and I couldn't find a single one that was changed from 4B to 4A. So that tells me that 4B is the new way to go, and I'd be for that. And by the way, I know I'm short, running short of time, 4B could pay for that ballpark, 100%. Now, the GEDCO's moving money around and paying $20,000 to $30,000. They approved to help the city pay for the ballpark, to pay for other projects that the city normally would pay for $20,000 to $30,000 a year. So GEDCO is in favor of the ballpark and supporting it.
I personally like the way it is now. We got a good director, Robert Johnson. We got a good board. Chairman of the board is sitting right here right now with us. I see no reason to change it. It's always been a hot political item. Folks have always brought it up back and forth, but I definitely would not change it. I would say with what we got, it's working good, so I would not be in favor of changing it. Thank you.
I actually spent an hour today talking to Robert and visiting about it. Did you know he wrote the book on it? If you look at the GEDCO book and you look under contributors, his name's in there. The man is highly intelligent.
Amen.
And I visualized, is there any reason to change this? He said, no, we're doing everything we can, what we got. The previous guy that run it did not know about some of the things they could have done. I would have loved to have some help on my park when I built it. You know, it would have been wonderful to have just a little bit of help, but they told me they couldn't do it. He says now, well, yeah, he could have. He just didn't know. So I think we're fine where we're at.
I'd have to go along with whatever recommendation Robert Johnson and his board of directors recommend. If that's what they think that would improve the city, go for it. But otherwise, the city has hired Robert Johnson to do what's the best for the city of Gladewater.
I'd be for the 4A and 4B. And the reason is it's going to open up another window of opportunity. We've sat here and talked about growth and growth and growth, and we do have a good GEDCO board, but I'm not sure that it wouldn't just open up more opportunities for us and help us in that manner. So, yes, I would be.
I'm not sure about the people who are running for office who aren't the incumbents on answering this one. So I suppose I'll just throw it out there and you fellas answer this and not the answer. How much interest did Gladewater pay in 2015? Except I bet you know. How much interest did Gladewater pay in 2015?
About $900,000, round numbers, close to that. I fact checked myself. I originally understood that the city had $16 million worth of debt. That was before the ballpark. That turned out to be not true. We've got 12.3. Melvin Harrison sent me all these numbers. We've got 12.3 million in debt. We've got 4.3 million in cash and cash equivalents. 1.3 million of that is restricted. We can't touch it. So there's roughly $3 million that you could subtract from 12.3 and know what our total debt outstanding is. But
according to Melba Harrison, our annual debt service is a little over $1 million. You know, and just like any mortgage, at the first years of that mortgage, most of it's interest, and then eventually most of it will be principal. So of the $1 million a year of debt service we have right now, I would say pretty close to $900,000 of its interest expense.
Mr. Wells, do you want to address any of that?
I think Mark can address that as far as how much interest.
Okay, the next part of this question.
Larry wants to say something.
Okay.
The city has four distinct entities. The Water and Sewer Department, which is called the Enterprise Fund, takes care of its own debt. I think it has, what, $4 million of that debt? Something like that. I brought my book, but I ain't gonna try to look it up. It's that important.
More like
and seven. And they pay that out of what you pay. It's self-sustaining. The other fund, I think they're around $5 million, the general fund, and that is what the taxpayers pay. So your taxpayer money is not responsible for the whole $12 million. It's for around five. The money you pay in on your water bill, your sewer bill, all this goes on the other, okay?
Anything? Mr. Wells, do you have anything you
want to
address?
No, I think that both of them did a great job
with
that.
Can you read the question? Yes. How much interest did Gladewater pay in 2015? The next part of the question they asked was how much is budgeted for 2016?
That's really an unfair question to try to answer and make it make sense. A lot of the numbers that Mark gave are close in numbers, but it's just not a question that I can answer or any of us could answer and make it make sense without causing more questions. So that would be one of those questions I would encourage everyone to ask us after this or at another time, or ask the city to give you something. But I can answer you in much better detail, but just not in this setting.
Yeah, we could answer better if we had the paperwork laying here.
Right.
So.
Okay, I am comfortable with this question. This is something that's close to my heart. The city obviously is struggling financially. We're all aware of that. We understand that. This question is from someone who is concerned, and I didn't write, who is concerned about the library roof. and the damage to equipment that's continuing to occur. Also, the way the library looks, since obviously it's a very public place. Now, what they have in their question is they discuss the roof issue at the library. And then they have a pointed question at the bottom that how, you know, I'm juggling the question here. But the prioritizing, because they talk about the fact that the city hall remodeling was done in the lobby, but we've got damaged books and damaged equipment and growing mold in the library. So I suppose that's the point of their question.
You're the mayor, you get to go first. All rise. No, that's it. My wife said quit saying that, place at church for the past offering plate. Years ago, Upshur County, they funded that library all the way through after a generous donation from Miss Lee, whose name's on that building. That it's sat down there for years and years, and finally Upshur County said, we don't care what y'all do, we're not gonna give you hardly any more money at all for that building. So then it was turned over to the city. So all of a sudden, we have more and more building to take care of. And the city is gonna look after that building. And we've had a man who don't want his name mentioned, but he went up and had his man fix that roof. And we were hoping it would quit leaking for a while till we found out some way to put a brand, what I call a brand new roof on there. The old flat roofs are horrible. The deal at the city hall wasn't really a total remodeling, it was a safety issue. And we're still working on that, where people just walk right in and they put those bars up because we have employees down there and there is a lot of money taken in and out of that building. It's kind of hard to compare one thing to another thing, but I've been a friend of the library ever since we've been in town in 74. And we will do what it takes to keep that library going no matter what. We get fewer and fewer dollars here and there, but we do have a great board of people with the friends of the library that helps out on that deal. So thank you.
It's probably not a fair question to those who've not been involved in this, so you know they wouldn't be able to answer the same way. But we have come up with a solution to replace the roof at the library. That's kind of a recent development, so it's not as widely known, but we have come up with different ways. We are selling some city property that we don't utilize, and we're using that funding to, and this being one of those projects. So we have come up with a solution to get the library roof replaced, and that's fairly new. So again, that just so it's not unfair to anybody else here that knows that.
Well, I've been down there. I don't know how many of you have been in the library and looked at this situation. It's sad. It's a public building and it needs to be fixed. Should have been fixed, but when you patch a little here and patch a little there, sometimes the buildings, you know, water has a funny way of finding its way inside. And when you've got books that could be very old and historic things inside there that could be damaged, that's a waste. And I'm glad to hear Ms. Niemann says that they have something in place. I'm glad to hear that. It's time. But I think sometimes the priorities of buildings, that's been damaged that way for several years now. It needs to be fixed, and I hope that it does get fixed in a timely manner. The longer it goes, the worse things get, and the more it costs to fix it.
Okay, we're going to pause for another commercial here. The Friends of the Library book sale continues this next week, and we really need you to go down there and shop those books because the funds will support the summer reading program. This advertisement was brought to you by the Friends of the Library. Good job. All right, here we go. This is a question everybody can sink their teeth into. And And I know it's an idea question. Someone has asked you, how do we attract young families to Gladewater? We have an aging population. How do we attract young families to Gladewater?
Well, the schools would be the first place you'd start. That's a good area. And then there's got to be things here, you know, and this is just maybe a dream, but a water park or some other amusement park, some things that attract the younger age. We've got a lot of opportunities, but we have to put our minds together and figure out what it is that really attracts people. But again, we've got to do some things to get the town in shape for that. You can't just move people in and we've got the problems that we've got. The larger the growth, the more the water, the more the other problems. And so we need to take care of what we've got and look forward to that day and move forward towards that goal.
This kind of plays into that earlier question about business and residential recruitment that we discussed. And to get younger families here and get more families moving into town, I deal with this on a daily basis as a realtor, and I see what they're looking for and what their issues are. It's never the water. It's not things like, it's not the things that we are so strong about. They don't even know about those yet. So, you know, we have to, the solution to this is that we continue to work with, and I wrote a couple of names down here, the CM Raven Group, more local builders, and builders like Scott Hamilton, who is building a lot in Longview and they're not building here. And the reasons those are, it's issues that we're facing. A lot of it has to do with land mass and then the cost of the land. If we cannot get people who own land to let it go at a reasonable price, we cannot force anything like that. That's something that we have to do as a community. The beautification that we're working on through town, the services, the quality of life perks, the ball field, you know, it's a strategic planning to increasing these growths. It's, if you ask a young family to come into town now, where are they going to live? What housing are you going to put them into? And knowing what we have for sale, it's generally not the housing that most young families, that middle-class families that have good jobs want to move into our area. We have to approach this methodically. And in every area, there is no one priority. We're talking about priorities of roofing, priorities of safety, priorities of our EMS services. All of these are, they're all priorities. And they go in line this way. They don't go in line this way. You have to work on everything at the same time in the best way that you can with the funding that you have, the resources that you have, the home grants that we use, all of the things that work together to make this happen. So I think in order to attract young families is we have to continue with the progress that we're making and make a little more by hopefully some community involvement in that.
Yeah, the new school I think will help. I met with the Kilgore Economic Development Corporation director many years ago, and I asked her how many jobs that they had gotten for Kilgore in the last 20 years, and her honest answer was about 3,000. You divide that by 20, and you come up with a number. And but she was very honest. She said, but I got to tell you, my labor pool is Longview. So I said, well, let me get this straight. You're using sales tax money from Kilgore to bring jobs to Kilgore or to Longview? And the answer was, yeah. And her explanation for that was that they didn't have the housing in Kilgore for the labor pool. And the reason they didn't have the housing is because they didn't have the school district that they needed. So, you know, Mr. Pay-as-you-go voted for the school bond, even though I had some reservations about it. I wish it would have been a 15-year bond instead of a 30-year bond, but a lot of people worked hard to get that grassroots thing going, and they came up with what they thought was the best solution. But, you know, these bonds, anyway, the answer is the schools and the ballparks, all things that cost money. And we're financially strapped, and to make more progress, we need more money, and yet we're in debt to, you know, roughly twice our city budget, which is a pretty high number. The federal government, the budget is $4 million a year, and we're $19 trillion, so we're not as bad as the feds, But we are double our annual budget right now.
Okay, thank you. Of course, I was for the school bond, and we had a lot of opposition for it, but the people that was for it never let up, kept on working, because you have to have a good school system here. We came in 74, and we finally got a good school board that saw the need for a new school. But it was amazing how many people was very vocal and said, no, we don't need that. We're going to stay with the old one. And we just can't do that. We got to look ahead. If you want the young families here with the children, you're going to have the best school district. And I really think we got the best school district and the best teachers. And probably if you looked at the payroll, that's the biggest payroll we got in town right now. I know a lot of people live out of town, but they still spend money here from the school district payroll. We got Bumblebee Park down there. We got a splash pad down there for the children. We got the ballpark in, and we was talking about that. We cut that thing down from $5 million down to about 2-point-something million on the baseball field. We said, no, we cannot afford a $5 million deal. But you got to have something for them to do. A lot of them are going to work out of town. They're going to live here. We're going to always be a bedroom type town, I see. And sometimes that's good, because when those big companies are laying off, just like they've been doing in Longview, it don't hurt us that bad, because we don't have that many big companies here. Thank you.
The school is a keep-in, like Mark said. That's a big thing. I've worked for the school 5 years. I was a plumber, and I've seen some crazy stuff, so I'm excited they've got a new school. I'll tell you a little story right quick. If you ever went to the middle school downtown up on the hill, there's a big mirror there at the end of the hallway. And you walked down there and you looked at that mirror and it had a sign up there, this is our favorite people. And it, you know, made the kids feel good. And the fire marshal come in there for the state. He said, you can't have that up there. If there's a fire, they think there was people running at them and they turn and go the other way. We took it out and put it down the basement. Leaned it up against the wall down there with Lionel Cluart, and I carried it down there. Next morning, I'm in there checking the boilers, and I come in there, I turn my flashlight, and I seen the guy in that mirror. I like to have a heart attack. I'll never forget that. But the school is a great thing. But if you go to a town and you're going to stay in a nice motel, what do you look for? You look for amenities. You want the pool, and you want a sauna or this and that. A town to grow has to have things to offer. The ballpark is a good thing. It is a very good thing. It's expensive, but it's a good thing. We need to figure out what other amenities we can offer people to lure them from going to another town. That's what it's going to take, vision.
I have had the privilege of interviewing city manager, the previous city manager, before when he came in for the interview. And also when we got a new pastor here at First Baptist Church, things that they were looking for, one of the first things they looked at was our school system. Did we have a good enough school system for their children? And I was 200% in favor of that bond. Folks, I went 1st through 6 over here at Broadway and 7 through 12 up on the hill. That was our high school. Those buildings they needed updating terribly bad. They're not set up for what we need to teach our children. And thank God we're getting some new buildings down here. They're moving the 2nd, 3rd graders from Broadway over to Weldon, where they've added to it. And then the middle school will be in that new campus. And when people look for a place to move to for quality of life, they're going to, young couples, you bet they're going to look for at the school system. Another thing, our church has, and this church here, have great youth leaders. And that's another thing that young couples are looking for when they come to a town. They want to go to a church that has a youth leadership program. And that means a lot to the people that's coming here. And I'll tell you what, as far as quality of life, we do need the ballpark. We were in a pinch. We don't want to let these kids down. I had three boys that played Little League Baseball here. And another area that we have that's good for Gladewater is our lake down here. If you go down there on the weekend, you're going to see a lot of cars and a lot of people out there. And that's a good draw for Gladewater.
Are the candidates, excuse me, are the candidates for or against the certificate of occupancy, and what other ordinances would you like to have in place in the city?
Yes, I'm for the ordinance. There is, it's still being developed. And right now, we're not at liberty to discuss what is in it, in the ordinance. City manager will be back in town, and we hope to bring up something Thursday. Everybody come to city council meeting Thursday, okay?
I would like us to try to do some other things first. Instead of coming out with a sledgehammer, I think we ought to start with a fly swatter, you know. The reason being, there's a lot of houses here in town, high-end houses that are rentals, that this is unnecessary. But there are some that do need it. My suggestion was that we make up a bill of rights for renters. When they come in and put the water deposit up, this bill of rights would be on the second page. They could read that and say, if you're looking at a house, this is the things you ought to expect that house to meet, all your needs. If it doesn't, call this number. Because that person renting that house can call and ask for an inspection. I think they also ought to make the people that own the houses have that same sheet of paper behind their application. And when they fill out the application to rent the house, they could look at that piece of paper and sign it that they did. And that way, I think the problem would take care of a lot of itself, rather than making everybody knuckle under. That's my personal opinion.
Okay. I'm definitely for some kind of a control over these houses. I feel like we're going to have that public hearing again. You'll get a chance to speak again like you did last month, but more time. I allowed you a lot of time to speak on that, and I'm glad you did, because we found out more and more how you felt about it. But one ordinance can't just fit, I think, everybody. You're going to have to look at, I think, what the house is, how many people live there, the duplex, or is it a building downtown. But I think we're going to have to hear from the people, hear from what I call the city management, and we're going to have to come to some kind of compromise that where we can live with it. And because the renters, they come here, they spend money, you know, and the renter ought to have the right to call and complain, either good or bad, with the house on there. Because we got a lot of good houses here, and we got a lot of good people here. I just feel like we got to work out something that'll work for all of us and not just one or two of us on there. But I am for an ordinance, but I don't think we've got it right in place yet as far as approving it. Thank you.
I'm for a compromise. The problem with the original ordinance that they passed was that the people that it was affecting weren't represented at the city council. The only person I remember speaking was code enforcement, Al, Chief Fine, and some members of the city council, which kind of reminded me of the forced annexation thing. We really need to have people, we should be passing laws or ordinances that affect people without them having some input at the city council. And if I'm successful enough to be mayor, I'm gonna make sure we're gonna invite people that these laws or ordinances affect to come ahead of time and not tell them, oh, by the way, we just passed this and now you've gotta comply. I think that's just not the right way to do things.
I think every ordinance affects someone one way or the other, and the ones we pass. You know, we're working on city ordinances and processes to establish safe and healthy environments, and that's what I'm for. So I'm going to take my time to answer a couple, make a couple other comments about a couple other things. Is Mark, you had said we, you know, are in debt double our annual budget. Again, if you separate those two things out, our annual budget is a little over $6 million in general fund, and we're $4.7 million in obligations. So it's not the full amount. Part of that is enterprise fund, which again self-sustains itself, and there is a $604,000 overage of net revenue in that account. So it has its things. Also, on the growth, we gave away over 20 awards at the Chamber for Economic Growth, and those were for expansions. We've had companies, J.O. McKeag, others that have expanded their businesses while here. So our businesses that are here are growing, and they are expanding. We've had new businesses, Tommy L's Trucking and so on, Textile and Brake, Cutting Edge. We've had growth in that area. And we've had ones that's doing training, like the massage school does now training and does educational to get people qualified to make a living in there. So, sorry. That minute doesn't last very long.
I kind of feel like Larry Seery. I like what he said a while ago. I think we need to explore this a little more. Sometimes, an old saying from Andy Griffith, because I happen to like Andy Griffith, sometimes we pick our peaches before they're fuzzed up good. And, you know, there's ordinances in place, and I know we keep talking about ordinances, and some for work, some don't. I understand all that. But yet, what's in place was put in place for a reason. Now, if that house is not in the right condition and you're going to move into it as a renter, why would you move into it? If it's not right, it needs to be fixed right. And so if there's an ordinance for that, that ordinance, the way I understand it, is good for both sides. It's good for the occupant. It's good for the landlord. And you know what? I think most people have a good heart and want their houses to be in good shape, and I think they want good tenants. But we need to look at things instead of just jumping out there and putting another fee out there for the landlords. And I think we need to take a closer look. And if y'all wasn't at the last city council meeting, I'm going to say this publicly, and I hope he doesn't mind me mentioning. JD, you did a fine job at the last city council meeting. You took on what you needed to, and I appreciate what you did and what you had to say. And I think the other city council people were behind you. They might not have had an opportunity to speak as much as you did, but I appreciate what you did. You handled it very, very well, very professional.
Okay, we're gonna do a speed round. So we can get in at least two more questions. We'll do it just real quickly, and then we're going to give you an opportunity to have some time to say the things that you would like to say that you haven't had an opportunity to say. So since the microphone is here, we'll start here. So 30 seconds. The city gives all of its hotel motel tax to the Chamber of Commerce for use in promoting the city, and that's great. But how can the city help promote the downtown antique district more? No one's coming from Tyler to go to the Sonic, and local businesses have had to dip into their own pockets to help pay for billboards and advertising. So speed round, guys.
Put a line item on the agenda for the downtown merchants.
Well, all the hot tax that goes to the chamber that does the advertising for these, it does go for billboards, and all those billboards advertise for the downtown district. They don't advertise for the rest of Gladewater. It's about the antique district. All the brochures that you see will be about antique district and about our downtown and focusing on those. So most of it does go towards the downtown and focusing on downtown.
I think the merchants get some help from Main Street. And the money that goes in there, and I know at one point Getco was paying for a billboard advertising the antique capital of East Texas. So they get, no, Getco didn't pay for that?
Yeah.
Who paid for that? The chamber did? Okay. Well, I stand corrected. What was the question again?
But you gotta be quick.
Gotta be quick, 30 seconds. About the chamber and the...
Yeah, the city gives all its hotel motel tax to the chamber for use in promoting the city. What else, I guess what they want to know is what else can we do to promote the antique district effectively?
Okay. I think sometimes we leave that up to chamber or Getco, whoever. We ought to be on the promoting this thing every time. I mean, it's not much, but I give $38 a month to Diane for that billboard out there. I stepped up. Nobody else didn't want to at that meeting. I thought $38, that's nothing. You know, but then sometimes you think about time. Sometimes you need to do this, you need to do that. Don't worry about sometimes what the money's going for. Just help them out. People stop at my business all the time, won't buy my junk. I don't want to sell my junk. I want them to sell their junk, which they call antiques. So I send about 3 or 4 down there every day. And I'm proud that they're down there because I know they're going to get that mayor discount, I call it, which is a built-in thing there. But I feel like I'm a friend of the business people, and I'm a friend of the people that live here.
When I built the park, I went to the city. I went to the folks downtown, and I talked to them. Benny was, that's how I met Benny. And I said, I want to tie this in with you, the RV park with the downtown area. That's why it come up Antique Capital RV Park. I wanted that recognition. And I have a lot of people come in there, and I think they come down there and shop. I'm not trying to pat myself on the back, but I spend a lot of money every month with CBS, and we run an ad. Maybe you've seen my ad. I do everything I can to promote Gladewater because I believe in Gladewater.
We do have billboards out on the interstate. However, they need to be put in a different location. The one up here on the west side should be put west of Canton instead of east of Canton, because so people could see that and come on into Gladewater. But that would be another placement for advertisement of the antique district would be a good help. Now, the money that the chamber gets, I feel like that they put in a lot of advertisement for the antique districts.
Thank you. Okay. You each have 2 minutes to use as you wish to speak to the audience about why they should vote for you.
Okay. Again, I've raised right here in Gladewater all my life, and I love Gladewater. It's home to me, has been to my family. And when people ask me why I'm a politician, I tell them, well, I'm not a politician. I'm a public servant. And I'm on this council not to be a politician, but to serve the citizens of Gladewater. And there are certain areas that I feel like that is my responsibility, and is to provide the safety for our citizens, to hire the best police chief, fire chief, city manager. All these areas, it's my responsibility to see that the city makes the best use. I'm involved in the recruiting process. I retired from Texas Eastman over in Longview. I was able to get on then in 1963 when I couldn't find a job anywhere else, and they were good to me. They let me stay there 37 years, and I retired on my own. But I know that people over there, when they were looking for an automobile or a house to buy, I'd recommend Gladewater. So I'm still promoting Gladewater wherever I go. And I would pick up, some of these guys would buy cars from J.O. Williams or McKeggs or anything like that. I would pick them up in the mornings when they brought their car in for repair and bring them back in the afternoon. I'd like to see the appearance of the city. I was talking about the lake down here being a big draw. There's probably more folks from out of town go to that lake and the picnic area than the people that live here. Am I 2 minutes out?
Like I say, I believe in Gladewater. And if you'd asked me 2 years ago if I wanted to be on the city council, I said, are you nuts? who wants that? But yeah. I think this Leon's done a fine job. He's been on there 6 years. I consider him a friend. He used to be Santa Claus at the mall, and he'd walk around there getting toys for kids. And so I've known him for a long time. I've known his wife when she worked at the school. I have a lot of respect for him. I just think I can bring out some new things. I've been a builder for 30 years. I built Telly's here in town. I've added on to Ace Hardware twice. I built Whataburgers all over around here in convenience stores. If you see a Kyle's Quick Shop, I probably build it. I know about business. I know about people. I've been a pastor for eight to 10 years in a little church up in Detroit. I wanted to preach so bad I drove 180 miles on a Sunday up there and back to preach in a little bitty church, and it grew a little bit. I love people, and I love Gladewater, and I want to see if I can help.
Thank you. This will be my fourth year as mayor, and I'd like to continue on. We've got a lot of things that I'd like to be a part of, and one of them, of course, is going to be the ballpark, wrapping that thing up and getting it successful. With the board, it's going to be a thing. When you look back, it's going to be one of those things. We should never put it off this far. But when the new school came in, and they, of course, we were forced to, and we need to get the lake store back open again. That's one of those PR things out there. There's no money in the store as far as profit wise, but there's a real convenience for the people that walk there to fish. And then when it's talking about the beach out there, there's 52 parking places, and most of those are filled with people. That's the only thing they can afford, to come over here from out of town and go down there on that beach and cook, swim, have a good time. There's no charge for it. I feel like I'm a people person. You can call me, you can talk to me. You may not always agree with me, but I'll always be straight with you. And I've never made a decision without thinking about it and praying about it and thinking it through. But sometimes you just gotta not be the right person to do the right thing at the right time. But you got to step up, just like we did with the school. And we had to let had to have a new fire truck. I called the day just to see what the thing's costing us. We're paying 2.75 interest on it. You know, we're not going to pay it off. We can pay about $39,000 once a year for that. But we got to start, and we got to keep on going in the right direction. But everybody's got to be positive for Gladewater, Texas. I'm not ready to, what I call, just sit down. I'm not ready to retire. I have a successful business here. I came in 74 with State Farm Insurance, and I'm proud to be 75. But I am your friend, and you can call me anytime you want to, and I'll do anything I can to help you. Is my time up?
Well, if I'm successful, I hope you continue to be an ambassador for Gladewater, because you're good at it. No, you're good at it. Briefly, about the enterprise fund versus the general fund, Atlanta informs me that we got about a $600,000 surplus. The enterprise fund, yeah, is paid by fees, but from a citizen's point of view, does it make any difference to your bank account if the money comes out for fees or for taxes? I don't think so. And of that $600,000 surplus, I believe about $250,000, is the $600,000 include the $250,000 that we're gonna kind of loan the city? Or okay, so we deduct that? Okay, the city was, after Sean Pate left, we found out that we were about $600,000 off budget, somewhere around there. And we're covering that by moving approximately $260,000 from the enterprise fund. It's supposed to pay for water pipes and stuff like that. We're moving it over to the general fund for some shared expenses where some employees do both. But we're moving money around to cover up the problem. We're also getting some help from GEDCO, which is funded by a half cent sales tax. So all of GEDCO's money is taxpayer money. So they're moving about $250,000 from GEDCO into the general fund, or no, let me rephrase that. They're going to pay for things that the city normally would pay for out of the general fund. It's my understanding that GEDCO is going to help the city because we're in a bind. But we're moving money around because we woke up all of a sudden and found out we're $600-something thousand out of budget. And my, you know, I keep hearing that Sean Pate told us we had the money. But if you vote for me, I promise you, I will read the financial statements, I'll look at the budget, and I'm not going to get surprised that we all of a sudden are overdrawn at the bank. Now, Albert Einstein defined insanity, quote, doing the same thing over and over again and expecting different results. Voting for the same person who led Gladewater to have the highest taxes and debt in the history may not be insane, but it's certainly not smart, in my opinion. Speaking of voting, citizens should make the effort to get informed and vote for candidates that can and will analyze financial statements and budget and not simply rely on the city manager's advice and counsel.
I respectfully disagree with some of those facts and figures that you gave, and that would be a discussion that you and I can have at another time. Those funds, we're not just doing a shell game. Those funds are meant to pay for employees that are doing dual purpose in these. It's not something that's just like, hey, let's move this to this and things like that. There are reasons behind all of these things that are stated. And again, please get with us individually or after this meeting or sometime in the future, and we can talk more in detail about that. I would like to continue as your council person. I appreciate and respect everyone who's trying to run for council. It's not always a thankful job and sometimes thankless, but it's very rewarding, and I find it very rewarding, and I would like to continue to be your council person over these next 2 years. My strong dedication to this community, I want to make sure that the best days of Gladewater are yet to come. They're not behind us, they're yet to come, and I want to keep that in mind through this growth, through all the things that we've facilitated over these last few years, and work to build upon those. That is how this city is going to move forward, is building upon and building upon and building upon. There is no one answer. There is nothing that any one person can do to make this change. We have to make good choices and keep building on that growth. And we do have growth. And if you don't know that growth, please, again, talk to your council, talk to your city staff. That's what we're here for. We need to hear from you. So I appreciate that you have let me serve you for the past 4 years, and I'm seeking your help in doing this important task and getting your vote on May 7th.
We've talked about a lot of things here tonight, things that would help our town and for growth. We've talked about cleanup. We've talked about our good schools. More opportunities. We've talked about the ballparks. We've talked about the bad buildings, the good buildings, the bad houses, the good houses. One thing we did not say that I want to say is how good our fire department and our police department are. Amen. You know, that's right there is... That helps us attract those families. I think if I was moving here, I'd want to know that, and I think you, the rest of you, would too. And they work diligently. They work for low pay. They put themselves, their lives on the line for us. And just the other day, there was a fire that was put out in 4 or 5 minutes that could have turned into a catastrophic event. But I just want to say that. We have sat here and talked about a lot of things. We've tried to answer your questions. We've answered them the best that we can. I think we have had a good panel tonight. I think we've had good questions. And I'll sum it up with this. I'll work for you and I'll listen to you. I'll be your vote if you'll vote for me. The one word that I want to say is unity. That says a lot.
All of you, and
And I want to apologize to those of you whose questions we didn't get to. If y'all were willing to stay here till 11 o'clock, we might be able to go through the whole big stack. And as a former social studies history person, I've got to say this to all of you. Whether they're an incumbent or they're running for office, this is a tremendous job and this is a tremendous effort that they're making. I hope because they believe in Gladewater. I believe it's because they believe in Gladewater.
That's that $100 a year that we're like.
That's
what we call.
It's a very difficult job. And for you to choose to run, regardless of whether you're an incumbent or running for the first time or for the 11th time, it shows a commitment to your city and to your community. And for that, we are all very grateful. We have one more commercial. We have one more commercial. Wait a minute. Okay. This commercial, everybody, we have a city smartphone app that helps to promote the city. The Gladewater Mayor is sponsoring it. We have other businesses that are participating. And you can go to this and you can press, you can pay your water bill on here. It's free. It doesn't cost you anything, the most important part. But you can go on here and you can look at history. You can look at city department information. You can go to the stores in town and look them up. And please share this with your friends because this is one of the ways that we can promote Gladewater. Thank you.
Gladewater360.com.
That's what he said.
They wouldn't want to hear about it.
I thought I heard something.